Hello friends, today we are taking the new topic, that is opportunistic mycosis. We will deal with this topic in two parts. In first part we will see what opportunistic mycosis is, and we will also see candidiasis in detail. So the objectives of today's sessions are: first we will see opportunistic mycosis, and then candidiasis in detail, in which we will see what are the predisposing factors which make this disease happen. We'll see the common clinical types or the features of the candidiasis, and finally the most important part for us, that is laboratory diagnosis. Now if we see general features, opportunistic mycoses are those fungal infections which are found in patient with underlying predisposing condition. As the name opportunistic suggests, that it would happen only if they find the opportunity. These infections are due to fungi of low virulence. The fungi may be inside the host already, that the normal flora like candida may turn pathogenic and produce opportunistic mycosis, or it may be exogenous. Some of the saprophyte like aspergillus may come in the host, which essentially is either immunologically compromised or having some defect. So the host, either, as I have said, the immunocompromised, whose immunity is not up to the mark due to any reason, or maybe having some other risk factors. So if we see host factor, in immunocompromised example is HIV. If person is suffering from HIV AIDS and CD4 counts goes below certain level, especially when it goes below 200, then person succumb to variety of infections, or maybe sometime hospital acquired infection, like example is catheter associated urinary tract infection. So if that physiological defense is breached, or the other risk factors like patient on steroid, so that drug would suppress the immune system and person become susceptible for this opportunistic infection. So these are the common host factors. Now the causative agent. So here the thing should be kept in mind, that host factor are more important than the causative agent. The reason is, if you remove the predisposing factor which makes the person immunocompromised, if it is possible, then it is very easy to treat this thing. So you don't have to think only of the causative agent, you have to also think about the factor that makes the host vulnerable for such infection. So basically, as we have discussed already, either it may be saprophyte in the nature, or it may be normal flora which is already there in the body. So the common opportunistic infections are candidiasis, aspergillosis, cryptococcosis, zygomycosis. Zygomycetes are the lower fungi like rhizopus, mucor. They also produces the opportunistic. Pneumocystosis. Pneumocystis xerovirti, one of the common infection occurring in patient with HIV/AIDS producing pneumonia. Penicillosis, that is due to penicillium. And basically any fungus in the found in nature may give rise to opportunistic mycosis if host factor is allowing it to produce the disease. And this is the medical mycology iceberg. The reported cases, as you know, that These are the reported cases and these are the actual cases, which is much more, because what happens that most of the time the person is not aware of the situation. The clinician may forget to find out the reason or the diagnose the fungal etiology, and they left untreated and pose significant morbidity and mortality to the patient. So whenever there is host factor which is conducive for opportunistic mycosis, you must think fungus as a causative agent of any illness. Because what happens when you are treating bacterial diseases, and if you are not having the correct diagnosis, but when you treat with broad spectrum antibiotic, the patient would recover even if you have not thought your diagnosis is correct. But that would not happen in fungus, because fungus, you need an entire different kind of drugs, antifungal drugs, to treat them. So it is very important that you should think of the opportunistic mycosis when the host factor is having some predisposing factor, and that is conducive to produce opportunistic mycosis. So with this, we are coming to the candidiasis. And the second thing which I would like to point out, that the number of opportunistic mycosis has there is a sudden, in past two decades it has increased many fold, and that is due to advancement in medical science. Now it may look contradictory to you, because any incident should decrease with the medical advancement, but the problem here is when we have a treatment of cancers, when we have chemotherapy, when we have organ transplant, when we are increasing the lifespan of HIV positive patient, then we are increasing the life, but at the same time we are increasing the person who are having predisposing factors. So organ transplant recipient naturally is having immunosuppressive drug, and then that person becomes vulnerable to develop opportunistic mycosis. So that is the reason that number of opportunistic mycosis has increased manifold. Okay, so with this we move to candidiasis. That is the one of the most important opportunistic mycosis. It is the commonest fungal disease caused by Candida albicans. Maybe in some literature it may be referred as candidosis or candidiasis. Both can be used. Moniliasis is also the word, which is because of earlier literature Candida was known as Monilia. So that is also sometime you may see in old literature. Or thrush, that is the clinical name, oral and the vaginal thrush. That is also can be referred as candidiasis. Basically it is an endogenous infection, because Candida are present as a normal flora in GIT, in skin, sometime in the ear. So they are normal flora without producing any harm. It would be there in immunocompetent host. But when the host immune system goes down, that normal flora turns pathogenic, and that's why they are known as opportunistic. So if we want to define it, it is a commonest fungal disease affecting mucosa, skin and its appendages and the internal organs. It is caused by various species of yeast like fungi belonging to genus Candida. So the infection may be acute or chronic, superficial or deep, and its clinical spectrum is so wide that it is difficult to make a specific definition. You may have candidiasis which is of no importance, or simple cosmetic importance like onychomycosis, the infection of the nail, or you may have the person may have candidiasis which is life threatening, which is candidemia, the blood, it may have candidiasis clear. So it is very wide clinical spectrum is there. So this is Candida albicans. Now you must have seen it in our earlier practicals. This is a yeast cell, which is typical ovoid cell, and they reproduce asexually by budding. So from they would produce a small bud over it. This is the electron microscope photograph of the yeast, scanning electron microscope photograph, where you can see yeast cell and a tube-like structure coming out of that. So this is how it grows. If I point out, this is the typical yeast cell, which is ovoid in nature, which would reproduce by such budding. Now, they may produce a chain of such bud. One bud, then the second bud, and it looks like hyphae, means filament. But you know that it is not a true hyphae, but it is a chain of the bud. That's why they are known as pseudo hyphae. So it looks like hyphae, but it is a chain of bud. This, while sometime it may produce germ tube, especially Candida albicans, where without any constriction there is a tube-like structure which is without any septa. But when such septa is there and there is a constriction here, that means it is not the true hyphae but the chain of the bud which has joined. That's why they are known as pseudo hyphae. So this is the morphology of Candida albicans, and these are the, this is how it would occur. As I have said, that it may be there as a normal flora in GIT as well as on the skin. So with some intravenous catheter, they may get access to the blood vessel, and from GIT also they may produce oral thrush. They may disseminate into other organ also. So this is how it produces the infection. And the common agents which produces candidiasis, we have already mentioned the name of Candida albicans, but it is not the only only species. There may be other species which are collectively known as non-albicans Candida. So these are Candida tropicalis, Parapsilosis, Kefir, Glabrata, Cruzi, Gulirmondi, Viswanathi, and recently identified as Candida auris, which shows considerably high resistance towards various antifungal drug, and that is a matter of concern. In developed countries, they are finding it very difficult to treat the auris. Sorry. So these are the common agents. There may be other species also, but these are the common species which we encounter. But out of all this, the most common is Candida albicans. Now we see the predisposing factor which makes the person vulnerable for this infection are physiological, in that the extreme of the age, that is elderly and the infancy, naturally the immune system would be low. Pregnancy, especially in the urine, glycogen would be excreted, and vaginal candidiasis may occur in the pregnant female. Traumatic burns and the infection, which would destroy the mechanical barriers of the body, which makes the person vulnerable. Hematological are the cellular immune deficiencies due to various leukemia, HIV/AIDS, and by any other reason. If immune system and especially CMI is deficient, person is prone to develop candidiasis. Endocrinological, diabetes mellitus. The high sugar concentration favor the growth of fungus, and especially Candida, being the normal flora, would excessively grow. Iatrogenic, the antibiotic, large broad spectrum antibiotic which would clean up all the bacterial flora, and it would be a free ground for the candida to flourish. Steroid, chemotherapy, catheter, these all are the factors which would favor the growth of candida. So these are the common predisposing factors. Clinical features may be infectious, mucocutaneous, in that oral thrush, stomatitis, glossitis, etc. Alimentary, esophagitis, gastritis, genitourinary system, there would be candidiasis, chronic mucocutaneous candidiasis. So this is oral thrush. You can see the white patches in the buccal capsule, even on the tongue. So that is thing. Then it may be it may produce cutaneous on the fingers or generalized onychomycosis, that is of the nail, diaper dermatitis seen in the infants. So these are the pictures of the nail, interdigital lesion on the foot, in the groin region, and the diaper which has become generalized. There may be systemic of various things. So UTI, endocarditis, pulmonary meningitis, candidemia, that is in the blood. So various organs would be affected due to candida. So these are the pictures. And second is, so all of the above which we previously mentioned were allergic. And now this is, what we previously mentioned were infectious, and now this is allergic, that is ID reaction, candidiasis, eczema, asthma, gastritis, etc. That is basically allergy to presence of the candida and its metabolites. Now we are coming to lab diagnosis. How to diagnose candida infection? So the specimen would be depending on the site which is involved. For example, if it is oral thrush, you can collect the swab, vaginal thrush, oral swab. In vaginal thrush or the vaginal candidiasis, you can take vaginal swab. If it is candidemia, you can collect blood. If it is in lung, sputum, etc. So specimen depending on the site involved. Microscopy, wet mount can be done, gram stain can be done, you can see gram positive, KOH preparation. So that is microscopy, you will see plenty of yeast cells and even pseudo hyphae. Presence of pseudo hyphae is indicative of actively growing candida. Sometime even biopsy can be done. Culture is done on the sebrodextrose agar. This is candida in gram stain. You can see gram positive, yeast like cell, and the hypha like structure, which is actually pseudo hypha. The colony is creamy, moist colony. Unlike other fungus which produce velvety or the filamentous colony, candida colony is just like bacterial colony, white, creamy, and moist colony. So this is here if you can see, this is on sebrodextrose agar and this is on the blood agar. It has a typical curdy smell also, that is colony of candida. The identification is done by germ tube test. It is very important test which can be used to differentiate candida albicans from the other candida. That is, all other can be collectively named as a non-albicans species. So albicans and dublinensis, two species of candida, will give germ tube test positive. It is also known as Reynolds brood phenomena. The other test is chlamydospore formation. Again, that is done by the albicans. That is done on the corn meal agar. You can do various biochemical tests like bacteria. And there is a ready-made chrome agar is available, on which different species of candida produces different color of colony. That would help us to diagnose the species. And we have to do antifungal susceptibility testing also. And immunodiagnosis. Candida produces various menin antigens are there that can be detected, or antibody against that. That also can be detected. Now, if we see germ tube, the procedure is very simple. You take the serum of the healthy human being, and the candida which has been isolated on the sebrodextrose agar, that is mixed with the serum, and it is incubated for 2 hours at 37 degree centigrade in incubator. Now, this is germ tube test positive and this is germ tube test negative. If you carefully see the difference between these two, this is his cell, same way this is his cell, and you can see there is a tube-like structure is arising out of that. So this tube-like structure is germ tube. Only albicans produce such germ tube. While here also, if you see, there is a tube-like structure, but if you carefully see, this tube is having constriction. It is not a continuous extension of the cell. Here, if I put the arrow, here there is a constriction. So this is not true germ tube. So this is germ tube negative, this is germ tube positive. So Candida albicans produces germ tube test. And one more, which is known as dublinensis, which is basically a biotype of Candida albicans only. They are producing germ tube test positive. Rest of all candida give germ tube test negative. It is very important to differentiate between albicans and non-albicans. The reason is very simple. Albicans usually shows less resistance towards azole compared to non-albicans. So when you identify the candida, and if it is albicans, can be easily treated with azoles. While if it is non-albicans, you need antifungal sensitivity test and you need to see whether they are sensitive to azole, or there are some non-albicans like Candida cruzi. They are intrinsically resistant to all azoles. So fluconazole and all that drug cannot be used to treat them. That's why it is very important to differentiate albicans and non-albicans. So germ tube test, it is a very important topic. Many times it is asked as a short question also. So you must understand. You can read the book also. The other tests for identification are the on corn meal agar. They would produce such refractile structures. I just point out the structure. This is the real picture, and this is the drawing. So such structure, refractile structure, are known as chlamydospore. So that is a typical feature of albicans. This is how Candida albicans grows on the chrome agar. It produces typical green colonies. Different species produce different color. So that would help. The other test is sugar fermentation and assimilation test. Different sugar are there. And based on that result, you can identify the species. This one is fermentation test. and this is assimilation test. Assimilation is nothing but it is the ability of the fungus to utilize that sugar as the only source of carbon. Then it would, for example, if one candida can utilize dextrose as the only source of carbon, that means they are able to assimilate dextrose. So that is the assimilation test. And antifungal susceptibility testing on molar Intanagar with methylene blue and glucose, it can be used to test the antifungal sensitivity testing. MIC can be done in the Vitek 2. In our automated system we have MIC values also, so that these are the ways by which we do antifungal susceptibility testing. Especially it is needed in the patient who is in ICU and suffering from serious infection of candida. Treatment, there are various antifungal agents like ketoconazole, miconazole, nystatin, nystatin. These are the cutaneous for systemic, amphotericin B, fluconazole, itraconazole, etc. So you may have read the antifungal agent in detail in the pharmacology, so we are not going in that detail. Summary, candidiasis is commonly asked as a short note. So when that is asked, you have to write about the etiology, you have to write about the clinical types of candidiasis and in detail laboratory diagnosis and the identification like germ tube test and all that. Clear? So you must remember the common species of candida that produces the infection and the lab diagnosis, which is the most important. So with this we finish today's lecture. Thank you very much for watching this. Thank you.